Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second of our webinars in the series, Unpacking the Exam Journey. My name is Charlotte Pritchard, and I'm in the secondary schools team at Cambridge University Press and Assessment, and I'll be your host for today's session with Olha Madylus. Before we get started, I just want to highlight that this is actually a re-recording of the 4th of April webinar, as we had a few technical hitches. So the Q&A from this webinar is from the original recording. So without further ado, I'm pleased to welcome Olha Madylus, who will be talking to us today about unpacking the exam journey, speaking and listening, the road to success. Olha Madylus has taught in the UK, Greece, Hong Kong and Venezuela. She is a freelance author, materials designer, consultant and teacher trainer. She's based in London, and as well as working with Cambridge, she does consultation, teacher training and teacher trainer training for organisations such as the British Council and Ministries of Education worldwide. Her main focus is on understanding and motivating learners. She's the author of Film, TV and Music, a photocopyable activities book for teenagers, published by Cambridge. So over to you, Olha.
Thank you so much, Charlotte. So it's lovely that you're joining us, even though you're not weren't at the original session, which is probably a good thing too, because I hope we won't have any technical problems today. But just one thing I'm going to say is that obviously, when we did the live recording, I was asking people to join in the chat, but that won't be possible. We won't be having that feature. So while I'm asking questions, though, which I still will ask, I'd like you to try and think about what your answers would be. So try and engage, even though this isn't live, try and engage with these issues, because I think you'll find it quite useful to think about where you're coming from in this. Okay, as Charlotte said, this is the second of three webinars supporting you and talking very much about how to help you to help your students to get the best results in their exams using the course book complete. The first webinar was done by Matt, and I would imagine that some of you have seen it. And this is what Matt had to say. Matt looked very much at planning a course, planning an exams preparation course, and looking at it as an entirety, not just individual lessons, but a journey. How do we begin the journey? How do we continue? And how do we reach our destination, which is so important? And he also talked a lot about how students may be getting quite good at English, their level might be getting good, but they still need to understand how the exam works. What do they need to do in the exam? Because it's not straightforward. There are lots of different kinds of questions and lots of things to do. And very importantly, they need to know what is going to get the best marks. How do we achieve that through understanding the question? So he talked about the handbooks, which are super useful. You can find them on cambridge.org. These are the exam level handbooks, and they give you lots of information of what's in the exam, plus how to help your students prepare. And he also mentioned, and I'm going to mention the website many times, I'm sure, that there are many support materials that are so accessible and so useful for you on cambridge.org. So that's where Matt left us. And he talked also quite a bit about reading and writing. I mustn't forget that. So I'm going to focus very much on listening and speaking today, and really looking at what exactly do students need to develop for their exams? What do the exams test, and what do the students need to do? And what is really important about this, and I will say this many times, is that what they're developing for the exam is exactly the same as what they're developing for real life skills. And this is where oracy comes in. And if you're not sure about this word, don't worry. I'm going to spend quite a bit of time focusing in on oracy. We used to call it communication, but there's a lot more to it than that. So just wait and see what that is. And I promise, hand on heart, that I will give you some very useful strategies and even some actual tasks, some activities that you can do in your classes. And whatever time you're watching this, you can probably bring them into your next lesson the next day or the next week. So that is my gift to you. And I hope you will find them useful. Let's begin with listening. Now, for my students over the years, they very often said that of all the parts of the exam, they found listening the most difficult and the most frustrating. And I do wonder if that's the same for you. So think about that. Do your students find listening easy or difficult? And what makes it hard? What makes it particularly tricky for your students to do well in the listening? Well, here's my list and see if you agree. I think the distractors, there's lots of distractors in the listening, especially as you go up the levels, things that confuse you, things that are not relevant, but can lead you away from the main message. And very often they're surprised. They're not expecting, you know, you don't know what's going to be in the listening test. So you don't know what you're going to hear. And that awful thing of just not being able to pick up, not being able to hear every word. And unfortunately, students do panic when that happens. And also, they can't hear the word, or maybe they hear it and it's not a word they know, or it's not a word they recognize when it's spoken. The speed can be an issue, especially as we move forward, especially if they're not used to hearing a lot of spoken English. And maybe there are some accents there, because we do get different accents in the test. So all these things can make it a bit tricky. So what do they need to do? What can we help them with in the classroom? So in the listening test, we need to tune in. We're coming to the test, we don't know what's going to happen in the test, and we have to tune in and work out the context. Now, in real life, we automatically do this thing, activate schemata, and I'll explain exactly what that phrase means. But I'll give you an example of what I do in listening, and I'm a great lover of listening to the radio. So first thing in the morning, I make my coffee, I switch on the radio. Because I live in England and I need to know the weather forecast to see whether I'm going to need my umbrella. So what do I expect to hear at the same time every day on the same radio station on my radio? I expect to hear people talking about the weather. I expect to hear things like the word rain. I really do hope to hear somebody say sunshine or clearing up. So what's happening, the activating schemata, means that in my brain, I am preparing for what I'm going to hear. And is that anticipation? Of course, you switch on the weather forecast, we're anticipating. We have some clues. I might be surprised. Maybe in July they'll say snow. That will be a big surprise. But that what I anticipate helps me even with the surprises, because it rules out what I was expecting. And as we anticipate, we're activating that language kind of subconsciously, but we're ready to do that decoding. So this is what activating schemata means. We start thinking about the subject, we start bringing in what we know, what we expect, and we activate that language, particularly that vocabulary. So how can we help our students do this in the exam, you say? Yes, this is reality, but in the exam, things are different. Well, they do get a chance to look at the questions, don't they? And here is an activity that I do with my students that they do actually really like. And I say to them, OK, we're going to do the listening on page 42, for example, but you're not going to listen. And they're like, whoa, what's going to happen now? And I say, OK, I want you to guess what you might hear for question A, B, C. And they start coming up with vocabulary. They say, OK, this is where does the boy live? Does he live in the cinema, in the pizza place? What might you hear then? Opposite, next to? So they start sharing all this language. And this is a technique that I recommend that they do in the test. And it's a very useful technique because it really does help them bring to the forward the language that they know. And make use of that time when they're looking through the exam paper before they start listening. Use that time well. Okay, so lots of things here that happen in the listening test that students have problems with. And I'm sure your students will say that they can't hear everything, they can't pick everything up, and they can hear some of it, but not all of it. So what we need to help them with is strategies to fill in the gaps, which are real life strategies. You probably don't notice, but you don't hear everything. You don't listen to everything that people say. We tune in and out because we don't need to listen. So have a go at this activity. I call it the mumbled or the beep dictation. So what I do at the end of a unit, I take one of the texts, I rewrite it because you don't want it exactly the same. You want an element of surprise. And I prepare it for a dictation. And I tell the students that if they don't hear what I say, they have to fill in the gaps with their critical thinking skills. What do you think is missing? So, for example, I'll do one mumble and one beep. So last winter, I went on an amazing trip with family. So you mumble a few words and they start going, what's going on? We don't know. I said, no, what do you think it might be? Or beep is just, we spent 2 days, beep Spain, beep, beep the ferry to Morocco. And it's actually a lot of fun. And the students have, they don't panic the way they do in an exam. They like this activity. And what it means is that they are preparing for the exam like that. They are actually using, because they say, I didn't hear. Doesn't matter. You know many things. And they don't need to know every word. They don't need to get it exactly right. But as long as they're on the right track, as long as it's, you know, they're moving in the right direction. And so if they miss out the word incredible, you know, you don't hear incredible or tasting food, they might say tasty food, horrible food, greasy food, but they're activating schemata. Okay, so what else do they need to do in the listening test? We said all these things. This is all critical thinking, filling in the gaps, guessing, predicting. But they also, crucially, have to recognise intention. Why is somebody saying what they're saying? We rarely just say something for this. We rarely say things like, this is a blue pen. This is not how language works. We have a reason. And this is the function. Are we being funny? Are we telling somebody to buy the pen? Are we trying to persuade them that it's beautiful? Why are we saying what we're saying? So what we need to think about, this is the speaking test then. Still having a few technical, that's not technical problems, that's all her problems. So in the speaking test, this is what they have to do. This comes from the handbook. It breaks down the different things they have to do. And if you look at the bottom, how is that similar to the listening? This is a really interesting thing. There's a real overlap between the listening and the speaking. And what is common is functions. In both papers, students need to A, recognize and understand, and also use functional language because it's real. This is what we do in real life. So you can do this wherever you are, on the bus, on your sofa, in the bath, wherever you are, you can do a little quiz in your head. And this little quiz is to get you to think about how functions appear at different levels and how many functions there are. So A2, B1, I'm going to show four functions. Where do you think they match? Where do you see them the first time? So have a little think about that. You can always pause the recording if you need a bit more time to think about it. These are the answers. And it's really useful as a teacher to know this, to know which functions appear at different levels. And you can do that by getting that information from the handbook and having a good look at the course book too, because this is what they will have to understand. And these are really useful things to use in the speaking test. So just for an example here, we've got an example in the listening, very typical kind of question here. You've got to spot the girl advising the boy. So what's the language of advice? And then in the speaking, we have a lot of speculation when it comes to the pictures, because you're not sure, you're never sure what's in the pictures. So particularly B2 level, lots of speculation. It could be, it might be, it may be, it can be, I think, perhaps, maybe, all that lovely language of speculation, which is really useful to use because we're never sure about life, are we? So how do we practice functions? And so much of what I'm going to say is about this. How do we get students to really use this? Because if they practice it, it'll come as second nature, it'll come naturally. So all the classroom language we use every day in the classroom, could you open your books? Can you find a pencil? Can I borrow? All this language, get them using it in class. Get them practicing dialogues together in English, making them up, doing some funny dialogues or reading them. And all sorts of different drama activities where they bring the language to life and they think about the meaning, not just the words. And not just, you know, sometimes in class, you know, I'm sure you don't do this, but some teachers let their students do dialogues and in such a boring way. It's like, what's your name? My name is. Horrible. It doesn't mean anything. They could just be saying bling, bling, blong. And things like presentations. A lot of teachers do this. It was so nice to see asking the students to stand up in front of the class or in front of a group and give a little presentation. And especially at higher levels, things like speeches and debates. Right. Here's another suggestion for you. How do you get students to do an interview? Because where do they get the ideas from? Well, this is what I do. Lots of the texts in the course book are about what people do, what they've done, particularly an interesting, you know, situation that happened to them. And what I say is I work in pairs, and one of you is the interviewer, and the other is, we'll call her Sally, who's been up in the Alps and something happened to her. And I act out the interview. And to make it really realistic, we're going to have a magic microphone. So take a pen, something like a marker, and students really enjoy doing this. And so what happened to you when you were hiking in the Alps? Oh, you know. And what they do is it it's relatively easy for them because all the language is in the text. They're just bringing it to life and practicing. And we really need to maximize that practice. And if we look at other functions, I mentioned classroom language. Here we go. Look at these kind of activities here, getting students to notice the functions that they need. But this is language that is not just for the test. It's what they can use all the time together. And that's very, very important. And what's really interesting and quite shocking, and I'm going to tell you a shocking story. Don't be too shocked, but I was shocked. So I was teaching in Greece and I had a lovely class at C2 level. And they were very, very good at all aspects of C2 English. But one day I came into the classroom, I was teaching, and I looked at the wall, the clock was gone. I noticed I'd forgotten to wear my watch. And I said to them, who can tell me what time it is? None of them at C2 level could tell the time in English. They made a real mess of it. And they were embarrassed, but they did say, you know, we learn to do this at elementary level, you know, A1 or even A2 level, but it's been years and we haven't used it since. So a really important thing to take into account is that if you don't use it, you lose it. So allow students to practice all aspects in the lesson, things like telling the time or, you know, asking to borrow something. Get them to use it in English because they will forget it. And this should be a shocking story to help you remember. Okay, so I'm going to focus in now on oracy. And if you don't know much about oracy, you can Google it and get lots more information. But I'm going to give you the big overview of oracy. And in the past, we talked about communication, but quite often it was very much at a very simple level. What's your name? My name is. But oracy has four different aspects to it. And we have to consider these when we're teaching. And it's true also in first language too, especially when students do spend a lot of time looking at their phones and not actually communicating face to face. So the linguistic aspect of oracy, this is the one that we really have already thought about for many years in the English language classroom. What vocabulary do you use? What grammar do you use? And to a certain extent, register. Are you talking to your bank manager? Are you talking to your little sister? How would that be different? But even things like using metaphors, jokes, all these kind of things. So how can we practice this level in the classroom? Well, you'll see, I'm going to be repeating myself a bit, which says these activities are super useful. So in class or for homework, a lot of things can be done for homework. And I say to my students, okay, on a Friday, I say for homework, and they all go, ooh. I say, I want you to watch a movie. I want you to watch a TV program, but in English. Get them to listen to as much English as possible. And this could be songs too. And it doesn't matter if they're listening to different things, because they may not all be interested in the same thing. The important thing is to build the habit of listening. So again, practicing things like drama, like dialogues, and using English authentically. Please pass me the blue pen. Now, the physical aspect of oracy has been lost in many classrooms, especially in the past. But when we speak, and I'm terrible, I'm normal, I think, I can't be still when I'm speaking. I wave my hands, I pause, I'm quite expressive. But this is natural. And it's really important that students integrate, so that's a good word, integrate this into their speaking in class and their pair work and their dramas, because this is natural. And I'll tell you for why. I have had students practicing for the speaking test and they sit opposite me and I ask them a question and their head is down, there's no eye contact, and they speak in a monotone or they mumble. And not making eye contact, not smiling, is a biggie. It's a really important thing that's missing in communication. So what do we do in class? Give presentations, project your voice, use your body, pretend that you're a politician, or you pretend you're selling the greatest board marker in the world. Do role plays and drama. Read things with feeling. So the acting, that part is really important. And it sometimes helps students to be acting because they don't feel so self-conscious as well. Now, the cognitive aspect of oracy, very important too. And I think particularly when it comes to the exam, I think the giving reasons and explaining views becomes more and more important, both for the listening and the speaking, and questioning as well, definitely for the speaking. So we're thinking as we speak, we're using those critical thinking skills. And I think, you know, especially as you go up in levels, there's more and more complexity in the speaking and the listening. So getting students to give more formal presentations, so they have that variety. One thing I love to do is get them to listen to speeches. I would guess you would know the speech by Martin Luther King, which begins, "I have a dream." It's the most beautiful speech, but the students really enjoy listening to it. We read it as well. But I said, well, how does he say it? How does he, you know, what's special about the way that he delivers that speech? The pauses, the repetition, etc. And a fabulous idea is to get them to make advertisements, to sell things, to sell ideas, or to sell. Well, lovely idea here. OK, in your class, get into groups. The school has €1 million or $1 million, whatever. And it'll give the group who has the best idea on how to improve the school that money to do the work, to make the changes. And you have to prepare it and you have to deliver it and we'll vote for the best idea. Unfortunately, there's no $1 million, but it's a nice activity. And also the social aspect of communication, the emotional aspect is really important. And you can see where this links into the speaking test, the turn taking, the listening, good idea, yes. And building up your self-confidence, which goes hand in hand, I think, with the liveliness. And thinking about who is listening to you. And they have to think about the examiner as a listener too. And I'll talk about that a bit later. So I keep coming back to it. Use English all the time for everything. But also, don't forget to teach the English they need for all these interactions. You know, very often, I'm probably guilty of this myself in the past, teachers say, right, get into groups and have this discussion and only speak English. Well, that's, you know, that is not a magic wand that the teacher is holding. They need help. They need some scaffolding here. So we need to provide that language. Great idea for doing this is to have posters on the classroom walls with lots of this language that they can refer to. And have something funny, like you must be crazy. Imagine they're you're said to them, I want you to do these five questions, multiple choice, in pairs, and compare your answers. This would be great. And if somebody gives a very strange answer, you must be crazy, would be appropriate and funny and real and authentic. And only by having this language can they really collaborate in English. We mustn't be disappointed if they're not using English if we haven't given them the tools. So think about that. And there's a lot of this. I've shown you some examples already. There's a lot of this. That you get these examples of that kind of oracy in the course book Complete. And the final thing I would suggest to help your students, particularly in the speaking, but they'll be listening to each other in class, is the aspect of creativity. Very often when I practice speaking tests with my students, I'll ask them a question and I'll say, okay, what job would you like to have in the future? And the student will look at me and say, dentist. And I have to say, bravo, well done. That's an honest answer, but it won't get you the highest grade. I said earlier that you have to be aware of your listener. The listener here is the examiner, and you need to showcase, you need to show the examiner that you know lots of English. So if we look at a sample speaking paper, and this again, this is from a handbook, so you know you can practice this in class. These are the kind of questions you get at B2 in the speaking. So practice this and get students to keep talking. Don't just say one thing, but keep talking and be creative. And it doesn't have to be true. Now, I'm not suggesting we should all become liars, but, you know, the examiner wants to hear something different. So, for example, tell us about a good teacher you've had. You know, think about what vocabulary you know. Oh, when I was at primary school, my teacher had a pet snake, and sometimes he brought him to school in his bag, and we loved playing with the snake, and we loved that teacher. Fantastic. Tell us about the things you like doing at the weekend. Don't say sleeping, say mountain climbing in the forest or the mountains. Say you enjoy cooking delicious meals for your family. Be creative. Okay. And I'm going to give you a little present. And this is probably the most useful thing that I've come across to teach your students. And I wish I could say this in every language that I know a little bit of. And it's this word. For many of us, we are taught that we use this, well, these two words, that we use it to say, that's a blue pen, or that's an apple, this is an orange. But actually, the most common use of this is things like this. That's interesting. That's cool. Ah, that's possible. This little chunk is so useful in so many situations. And you can use it with a single adjective, or you can use it with a noun phrase. And students start using this in class for everything. And they'll say, oh, that's interesting, when somebody says something not interesting. Or if I say, I'm going to give you some homework, they'll all shout, that's crazy, that's cruel, that's terrible. But this is such an easy thing for them to learn, and it's really communicative. And they can use it in that speaking test. So what is my top tip? What have you taken from this webinar that's made you think, oh, I really must do this? Well, my top tip would be use English for everything and encourage your students to with support. So it doesn't have to be part of the lesson. It could just be a little comment. Don't go to L1, don't go to mother tongue. Try and use English and give the students time to come up with an answer if it's there, and then really celebrate that. So, whoa, well done, Andre. Very good English. And don't criticize his haircut. Okay, I hope that you've got some good ideas from this. The questions you are going to hear in a moment from what we did on the 4th of April, but I will tell you that I have a blog and I'm also on Facebook. So if you'd like to get some more ideas, you can find them on my blog. And if you'd like to follow me and my teaching community, that we share ideas on Facebook and share links to webinars, etc., please join me there. Thank you. Thank you very much for paying attention.
So I'm going to dive into the questions that have been put in the Q&A box. I've got a few here. So what should I do if students are reluctant to speak English in class in front of their classmates?
Well, don't have them speaking in front of everybody is what I would say to that, because you get shy and you get very anxious if you're speaking in front of everybody. So I would make sure that they're speaking in groups, or I would go quietly to the groups and speak to them to build up their confidence. It's really scary to speak English in front of your friends, because sometimes children are a bit nasty and they laugh. So we don't want that. But also, if they're really reluctant, don't push them. Just give them, you know, because if you push them, it's very, very difficult, because they will just not like you and they'll feel very embarrassed. And also make sure that you scaffold your tasks. Make sure they're doable. So don't just ask them to speak about something and say, OK, talk about your favourite sport that you like to watch on television. I would say nothing, because I don't like watching sports. So you've got to make sure that the activity is really doable, and that the students will be able to do it. So as I said earlier, actually, get them to prepare things for homework. This really helps the reluctant students, because they can practice, they can write things, they can rehearse, and they can build up their confidence like that. And I know this is not something that you do just before the exams, but this is part of the journey. This is the beginning of the journey of building up those skills. Good question.
Yes, we've actually had quite a few coming in recently, just about the similar sort of thing, really, like inhibitions and afraid of making mistakes. I think you've kind of covered it in your answer.
I'm saying about mistakes is, if students start speaking about something in class, don't start correcting them. Let them speak. As long as they're getting their meaning across, you can keep a note of what their mistakes are and deal with them later. But you know, there's nothing worse. The student starts saying, oh, yesterday I go. No, I went. And they're like, oh, I don't have the confidence then to speak. So don't overcorrect them, just leave it to them. So that's a good point there, Charlotte, about making mistakes.
Okay. Another question here. Can you suggest any other listening activities to do in class or for homework?
Oh, loads and loads. Pair dictations are very nice. It's a listening and speaking activity where students have half a text each and they dictate it to each other and they write it down. So they're listening and speaking, and actually reading and writing too. So that's a very nice one. I would always say, my students for homework, you know, especially my poor teenagers who are doing so many different subjects that they examined in, for homework, I want you to watch TV or listen to a song in English. And it doesn't really matter. They don't have to listen to the same song. They don't have to watch the same TV program or listen to the same podcast. Whatever they do, listening in English is good and they won't listen to something they're not interested in. I don't. And also, I must say, Cambridge.org has loads of extra activities for all the different exam papers. And there's some fantastic stuff on there to practice at different levels, the right level for your student. So that's very, very useful for them too. So there's, but don't feel that you need to control it. You know, I think that's a very important thing.
Thank you. We're getting a flood of questions now, actually, so I'm going to pick a few. I've had an interesting one here about students working in small groups and how it's quite difficult to monitor what they're doing in a small group as opposed to in a big class. And have you got any tips for that?
Well, move around. That's what I move around a lot. I'm always moving. You're not going to hear everything that they're doing, but you do build up fantastic hearing, actually, because I can be near one group, I can be tuning into them, I can be listening to the others, watch them, see what's happening. You could also have, when you have a small group, you can actually nominate somebody in the group or ask somebody to volunteer to be a listener and to notice things and make notes of things and say, well, she said that, but I don't think that's the right word. So you can definitely, you know, don't stop doing group work and don't worry that you haven't heard everybody all the time. But try, if you notice, oh my goodness, Ali over there, I haven't heard him speaking for a while, go to his table, you know, make sure you're going everywhere. And if they're speaking often enough, you will hear them all. You know, if you only do it once a month, you're going to miss somebody. So that's very important.
Okay, so an interesting one here, I'll read it out. I use speaking presentations based on the exam questions. Are there other more creative ways of doing this, especially at higher levels?
Well, I did mention quite a few, you know, and you mentioned number in the chat box, get them to create, you know, TV adverts for different products, get them to make a speech, get them to do a mini presentation. So there are lots of ideas. And in fact, I can put some more, if I don't have any up, I can put some on my, I'm writing it down, I can put some more ideas on my blog for you. But there are lots and lots of great ideas to do. Just use your imagination, get them to, you know, what do you want to talk about? And remember what I said about the interviewing as well, get them to do that too. So there are, you know, there are so many things you can do if you free yourself from just being stuck to the course book, that you can jump out of it, you can do things in different ways. And also look at the teacher's book. There's always quite interesting suggestions in the teacher's book. And go to cambridge.org. Go to YouTube, where we have so many webinars with lots of advice like this. So,
yes, we've just had a question actually from a teacher. You were saying about getting them to use their imagination. And we've got a teacher here, Sarah, her name is, who's saying, how do you deal with students who claim they don't have any imagination? And it's difficult because they can't find any language to use that's not directly connected to their life. Have you got any tips for that? Or,
yeah, I think, I mean, this is a tragedy that students get to feel that they don't have any imagination. So, I mean, you can play different games to kind of stimulate imagination, definitely. I mean, just like my cat is a, you play this game and you've got to give an adjective for the cat with each letter of the alphabet. So I start, my cat is an angry cat. Next person says, my cat is a brave cat. And the next person, my cat is a cowardly cat. And just get them to generate language. But the more you encourage, the more you facilitate imagination, the more they will come in that direction. And rather than just say, come on, be imaginative, come up with an idea, be different, give them suggestions, model, give them nice ideas, etc. And it's, you know, it's actually a product of a very traditional education, unfortunately, that students don't feel they have room to be imaginative. And that's a really important thing. Definitely.
We've had a couple of questions here, Olha, as well. I think this is quite interesting. Obviously, there's lots of tasks for speaking tasks for groups, but a couple of teachers have asked about what exercises can you develop to help develop speaking skills when you're teaching one-on-one and when you've got just one student individual speaking activities. What can they do to practice?
Well, they can still do a lot of those things. They can still prepare, activities. And also you can do them with them, which makes I used to find one-to-one lessons a little bit daunting. But then when I joined in with a student and we would do interviews together or we would make an advert together, it really helped that student because they were seeing me as a model. But you just have to use your imagination a bit and think, how can I adapt these things? But most of the things they can do, especially if you give them time for homework to prepare something, to think about what they're going to talk about. And if you give them a different context, like one day you're going to make a speech and you're going to imagine that I am your government listening to your speech, or I am your school body listening to your speech. So give them different contexts for those activities.
Okay, thank you. And then I think we've got time for maybe just a couple more. Students love to revert back to their native language while completing a speaking activity, especially in group work. How can you avoid this or reduce this in a speaking class or during a speaking lesson?
Well, I think that kind of, to some extent, goes back to what I said before, that they might revert back because they don't have the language to keep using English. So this is where, if they have those wall posters with all that language, they can turn around and go, oh yes, I can use this. And it's just building up those habits. But sometimes I just think it's quite understandable if they're talking about something interesting that they might revert to mother tongue. And what I do is just try and remind them. And I had this thing that I used to do in Hong Kong, and I had a little paper cup and I drew a $1 thing on the cup. And if I heard them speaking Cantonese, I would just shake the cup and say, $1, $1. I never collected any language, but it was a reminder that they go, sorry. And then they would come back to English, because sometimes, of course, you're going to go into your own language because it's the most natural thing in the world. And I think you have to be very forgiving. They're not naughty. It's just that's what we would do, and I think that's very true.
Okay. Okay. I think we've got time for one last question now before we close. How many speaking and listening practice tests do you recommend for students to do before the exam?
Not too many, and not necessarily in class. I think there's a great danger of overloading lessons with practice tests. And I know this very well from experience in the past. I knew teachers that didn't really teach. All they did was give practice tests. So you have to balance this very carefully. What I would suggest is maybe do one whole test over some time, so the students get used to the format, they get used to the time. But I would set it for homework, because different students need practice in different areas. So if you've got some students that are doing very, very well in reading and they've got it and they have no problems, let them practice something else. So for homework, I mean, obviously speaking is a bit difficult, but they can, nowadays you can do the reading at home, you can do all the other papers at home, get them, I thought this is very useful, to get them to get an alarm clock, tell the time, use an alarm clock, time yourself, trust them to do that, because it's to their benefit. And talk to them about it. So we're not going to do too much of this in class because it's boring. And it's not, you don't need to do this. They need to take some responsibility for that too. So discuss it, talk about it with them. And if somebody said, I don't really know what to do in the listening. Okay, let's go through that. So really pull it together there. Oh, I mean, people are coming out in the chat box still sharing their ideas.
I know there's lots happening in the chat box.
And what's lovely is lots of you have your own ways of doing it. And that's fantastic, because there isn't just one way. I'm not an expert. I've done this for a long time. I'm just sharing my experiences with you. But different students need different things, and different contexts demand different things. So I think that's something to take into account, definitely.